So in today's lecture, we will be focusing on to the heat exchangers. So basically, what a heat exchanger means? Heat exchanger is defined as a mechanical device which transfer heat from hot to cold fluid with maximum rate and minimum investment with minimum running cost. So these are some of the objectives for heat exchanging devices that they are used. First thing, they are used to transfer heat. And whenever there is transfer of heat, I have already told you that heat transfer always takes place from higher temperature side to lower temperature side. So this will be the same what is happening in the heat exchangers as well. So heat exchangers will be transferring heat from hot fluid to cold fluid. And while doing so, we are required to see on to some of the points, that is maximum rate of heat transfer should be achieved. So whatever maximum rate of heat transfer can be achieved, we should target on to that with minimum investment and with the minimum running cost. So we are required to minimize the cost of this operation also. So we are required to minimize investment. Cost of investment means overall equipment cost and also its running cost. These are some of the examples for heat exchanging devices. You have already familiar with these: boilers, superheaters, reheaters, radiators, oil coolers, evaporator, condenser of refrigeration system, regenerator of gas turbine, water and air coolers or heaters, and several other industrial processes. So what we will be doing is we will be going on further in a sequential manner so that we can better understand what these different kind of heat exchanger devices are and how they can be used to transfer heat and how they are classified, so that their working principle, their mathematical relationships, what we can use for the evaluation of their performance, etc., can be gone through. So what heat exchangers are basically used for is they are used to condense vapor, evaporate fluids, recover heat to use elsewhere, reject low-grade heat, drive a power cycle, and several other usages are there. So practically, one of the example of a power cycle is a steam turbine. So here you are seeing that this red colored boxes, this is a line diagram basically showing you how this system can work. So a boiler is there, from boiler steam is drawn, and the steam is drawn. While the steam is drawn, it is sent to a steam turbine. So this trapezium you can see here, this is a steam turbine. It will drive the turbine, and then the steam which is spent driving this turbine will be sent to the condenser so that it converts steam back to the liquid form. Then feed water heater will be there so that it can be preheated and then sent back to the boiler. So this is a closed loop, and it is used to derive the steam turbine. And by driving the steam turbine, what we are doing is we are converting the steam heat energy into mechanical energy of a steam turbine. So steam turbine will be generating mechanical energy out of heat energy supplied by steam given to the steam turbine by producing rotational motion. So that rotational motion will be used to drive some other mechanical system. Now coming on to the classification of heat exchangers. Basically, there are many bases of classification. So based on some particular thing or some particular phenomena, or they are categorized or classified. So basically, we can classify on the basis of their operating principle, means the nature of heat exchanger process itself, then relative direction of fluid motion, whether they are moving towards each other or in the same direction, or at 90 degrees, or they are mixing together or not, like that. Then design and constructional feature, that how they are being constructed. Then physical state of fluid, whether one of the fluid or both of the fluid are changing their phase from liquid to gas or vice versa or some other. So on that basis, we are having these many classifications. So according to this heat transfer process, we are having direct contact type heat exchangers. In that, what will happen? Both hot fluid and cold fluid will come in contact with each other. So there will be no separating wall, and both fluids will be mixing together. So that hot fluid will transfer its heat to cold fluid, and both fluid will be exiting at one single outlet point where they will be having a common outlet temperature. Then second type is transfer type or recuperator type. In this case, the heat exchange process goes on continuously. So heat exchange process through the walls of heat exchanger, the walls which are used for conducting heat from one side, which is hotter side, to the colder side is conducted continuously. So hot fluid will be giving its heat to the separating wall, then that separating wall simultaneously will be transferring that heat to the cold fluid on the other side. Then third category is regenerators or storage type. So in this regenerator or storage type heat exchangers, what we are having is we are having hot fluid which is giving its heat to a system or a device where heat will be stored and then hot fluid will go away, or we can transfer that material in which heat has been stored and that can be moved out of the hot fluid, and then the cold fluid will be contacting the material which is storing the heat, and that the stored heat will be transferred to the colder fluid. So this is the storage type one, in which we are having heat exchange occurring at a different place. So heat transfer from hot fluid to the material which is storing heat, then that material transfer to the cold fluid and releases that. So it is like that suppose we are having a metallic sphere, and then that metallic sphere is dipped into the hot fluid, the sphere gets heated. So it is storing heat energy in the form of its raised temperature. Then that hot ball of metal can be dipped into colder fluid, and then that heat energy which was stored in that metallic sphere can be transferred to the colder. So this is how storage type heat transfer can occur. Then according to constructional feature, we are having tubular heat exchanger in which tubes or pipes are used. Then shell and tube type heat exchanger, in which there will be many smaller tubes placed into a larger pipeline or which is called as shell. Then finned type heat exchanger, in which we are having fins on at least one side of heat exchange surface. Then compact heat exchanger, which are generally called as plate heat exchangers also. Then according to flow arrangement, we can have parallel flow, counter flow, cross flow. In that also we can have mixed and unmixed flows. So a heat exchanger can be classified on these many bases, and one heat exchanger can fall in many of the categories. Suppose we are having a plate heat exchanger, then that plate heat exchanger can come in recuperator type of heat exchanger, as well as compact type of heat exchanger, as well as depending on direction of flow, it can be parallel flow, counter flow, heat exchanger. So this is categorization of heat exchanger. You can just go through this. I have already shared this file with you. In the direct contact type, the example is cooling tower, where two different fluids, air and water, they are contacting each other, and the heat is being transferred from one side to another side. So either air is hot and afterwards it becomes colder, or water is hot, afterward it becomes colder. So depending on for what it has been used, it can be done accordingly. Basically, as this is a cooling tower, it is used to cool the water. Then direct contact open type of heat exchanger, in which you can see the heating and cooling both fluids are entering the same compartment. So steam is coming here, cold water is coming here, both are mixing together and we are forming a warm water. So inlet for cold fluid, inlet for hot fluid, and outlet for mixed fluid. So otherwise what will happen, the heat exchanger will be having four different ports, two for inlets, two for outlets, one pair for hot fluid inlet and outlet, another pair for cold fluid inlet and outlet. This particular port is for non-condensable gases, if any there in any of these two fluids. So that non-condensable gases can form and they can be collected and removed from this particular point. So this is not taking part in the heat exchange process as such. Now in the case of differentiation of recuperators and regenerator, in the case of recuperator, I have shown already told you that there is a separating wall. This is showing hot fluid, this arrow is showing cold fluid, both are simultaneously running. So hot fluid will be transferring its heat to the separating walls, then separating wall simultaneously will transfer its heat to the cold fluid. So this is the recuperative type of heat exchanger, just like plate heat exchanger, shell and tube heat exchanger. Also in the case of regenerative heat exchanger, there can be a टर्बाइन और फैन और एजिटेटर काइंड ऑफ थिंग विच विल बी रोटेटिंग एंड देयर विल बी टू कंपार्टमेंट. एट लोअर कंपार्टमेंट वी आर सीइंग स्ट्रीम ऑफ कोल्डर फ्लूइड विच इज पासिंग थ्रू दिस एंड स्ट्रीम ऑफ हॉटर फ्लूइड विच इज पासिंग एट द अपर एंड ऑफ इट. सो हॉटर फ्लूइड इज हीटिंग दीज फिन्स और वेन्स ऑफ दिस एजिटेटर व्हेन दिस वेन्स रोटेट्स परपेंडिकुलर टू द प्लेन ऑफ दिस स्क्रीन. देन इट गोज टू द कोल्ड फ्लूइड साइड एंड इट ट्रांसफर्स इट हीट which has been stored while transferring the heat from cold hot fluid to the colder fluid and heating it. So this is the regenerative type of heat exchanger. Now compactness, how the compactness of a heat exchanger can be measured? It can be measured by heat transfer area per unit volume or by channel size. Channel size means how much is the distance between two consecutive plates or two consecutive surfaces of heat exchange. So that is the channel size. So conventionally heat exchanger just like saline tube heat exchanger, they have channel size ranging from 10 to 30 millimeters. So it gives about 100 meter squares of heat exchange area per meter cube of volume occupied. In the case of plate heat exchanger, they are typically 5 millimeter channel size. So they are having lesser channel size and hence more compact. So they are generally more than 200 meter squares per meter cube. So you are seeing that if you compare it with saline tube heat exchanger, for per meter cube volume plate heat exchanger which it is occupying, it is giving almost double, at least double the heat exchange area available for heat transfer. More compact types are also available. So this is a regenerated type of heat exchanger which I have already told to you, that there is a fan or a turbine type of thing. Hot gas is coming in that upper semicircle or upper half of this turbine. This turbine will be rotating and it will, the hot gas while flowing out will heat these fins or vanes. When they are rotating, the heated fins or vanes are coming onto the colder side. So this bottom half or semicircle part of this turbine, the cold gas is going. So that cold gas will be heated up by gaining the heat from this heated fins or vanes and hence cooling those fins or vanes again so that they can again take up or store the heat from the hot fluid. So this is regenerated type of heat exchanger. So this is the same thing, adiabatic wheel heat exchanger, recuperator explained already. This is also one type of recuperator. Plate heat exchangers you are already familiar with. So we are having many plates separated by some distance and in between two consecutive plates there will be one of the fluid, either hot or cold. So here you can see the steam shown in these red lines and product is shown in blue lines, product entering at the bottom in alternate pairs of plates. So it is entering here, then it skips this compartment, enters here, skips this compartment, enters here, then all streams are mixed together at the top and product comes out from here. Steam coming from the top side, it is alternating in between the pairs of plates, so it leaves the product side plates and enters the other side. So what will happen while these two fluids are traveling, then this steam will be transferring heat to this side as well as this side, this product will be receiving heat from this side as well as this side. So that is how this plate heat exchangers work. So this is a exploded view of plate heat exchanger. You can just go through this and also application. So this is not in, very much what is required to be explained. It is self-explanatory. You can just go through it. According to the direction of flow, we are having parallel or unidirectional or concurrent. So there are three different names. So this type of thing can come in objective type of question, that pick the odd one out and you are given these three options along with one more option. So that would be odd one out like that. Then counter flow, also known as counter current flow heat exchanger, then cross flow. So in the case of parallel flow, both fluids will be in same direction, counter flow in opposite direction, cross flow at 90 degrees. So here you can see other thing, double pipe heat exchanger in which smaller pipe is inserted into larger pipe. This is simplest, and one tube inside another tube. So in the inside tube we are having this end as this end acting as inlet and outlet, and any of the port can be selected as inlet and other will be automatically the outlet for the selected pipeline. So either hot or cold fluid can be entering this side, and at the out larger tube, we are having these two ports. So it will be entering at the bottom and exiting at the top. So always in this case, either it is shell or double pipe heat exchanger, the larger tubes or larger pipeline will always be having inlet at the bottom. Otherwise, what will happen if we are having providing inlet from the top, then liquid can just bypass, it can fall down here, and without touching this central pipeline, it can go to the outlet without transferring heat to this central pipeline. So if we are providing inlet from this bottom side, then this fluid cannot leave this outer pipeline unless and until it is completely filled with that fluid. So we are ensuring that heat exchange surface is not vacant, it is always wet with the fluid. So in the case of shell and tube heat exchanger, these tubes can be increased, number can be increased. So here in this diagram you can see one of the views, double pipe, I have already told you this thing. Then this double pipe heat exchanger can be placed in cascading fashion like this, so that this double pipe heat exchanger one can be attached to another, can be attached to one more, so that we can have a vertical growth, so that it does not occupy larger floor area. So we can bend it in U-turn. So for both fluids, we can have these many connections. Now coming on to the parallel flow or unidirectional flow. So here you are seeing that fluid one inlet here, fluid two inlet here, both will be flowing in the same direction in this particular part. Then outlet for fluid one here and outlet for fluid two will be here. This is parallel flow. And in the case of counter current flow, we will be having different. So you are required to go through this advantages and disadvantages. LMTD formula, I will be just explaining it to you in the derivation part. For counter flow, you just see here that in this case we are having fluid one inlet here, but fluid two inlet is at this side. So at the central part or in the between part, what we will be having is both fluids will be traveling in the opposite direction to each other. So it will be called as counter flow type of heat exchanger, or also called as counter current type of heat exchanger. So this is how the direction of heat exchange will be there. So this particular graph, this is showing the temperature distribution profile of heat exchange. So basically for counter flow type of heat exchanger, this is how we can have a temperature distribution profile. So this is basically a graph. In this we are having on x-axis length or area of heat transfer. So if we are considering this type of heat exchanger in which we are having hot fluid at the central pipe, cold fluid at the outer pipe or larger diameter pipe, cold fluid is entering at this right edge, hot fluid is entering at the left edge, both are in opposite direction, and then what will happen if we plot the graph from this side to this side and the x-axis, when the length is 0, suppose this is length 0, then length 1, 2, 3, like that. So as we proceed towards right from left direction, we are increasing onto the length, then how the temperature of these two different fluids are changed. So as the hot fluid is traveling in this pipe from inlet side to outlet side, its temperature will reduce gradually. So this is showing, this upper curve is showing how hot fluid's temperature is dropping slowly. So it is dropping in this particular fashion. Similarly, cold fluid temperature will increase. So cold fluid temperature from this inlet side, so now it is, as it is in opposite direction, so it is increasing from this end towards this end. So at length 0 part, it is having highest temperature, and as we go on to the right edge, it is at the lowest temperature. But it does not mean that this was the direction of flow. This was the direction of the graph we have been drawing. So this is the temperature distribution profile of heat exchanger, basically counter heat, current heat exchanger. So advantage, disadvantage you will be seeing. LMTD I will be just explaining. Now coming on to the cross flow. Cross flow, in the cross flow direction, you can see a fluid A is in this direction, left to right, but fluid B is in top to down direction. So the direction of flow of fluid A and B are at 90 degrees to each other. So they are neither in the same direction nor in opposite direction. They are in cross direction. So they are at 90 degrees or perpendicular direction to each other. In this case also we are having two different categories. Either one of the fluid can get mixed together. So here you are seeing that fluid A is in separate pipelines. These streams are not mixing together, but in this case fluid B can mix together. So these directions of flow you can see, stream A mix, B unmix. But in this another diagram, both sides we are having separate paths for flow. So both sides, stream A and B, are unmixed. So in the cross flow heat exchanger also we are having mixed type and unmixed type of cross flow heat exchanger. So this is how cross flow heat exchanger unmixed side type can be there. So we are having pipelines here, fins or plates here. So in between two separate plates we are having a channel for air to flow. In the tubes we can have some liquid. Suppose we are required to cool the liquid, a refrigerant or something, some other thing from the atmospheric air. This is how it can be done. In this case cross flow, this is mixed type. So here we are not having that fins, so the separation on this side has been removed. But in the tube case we are having unmixed fin type heat exchanger. So here you, in this diagram, it is much more clear that how cross flow type of heat exchanger can be there. So these diagrams you will be just referring to and go through. Now coming on to the mechanical design, the classification on the basis of mechanical design, we are having concentric tube, means tube in tube type, double pipe type, shell and tube, where we are having multiple tubes in one larger diameter pipeline or called a shell. Then multiple shell and tube passes. In the case of shell and tube also we can have multiple passes. I will be showing you with the help of diagrams. Then compact type, this is plate heat exchanger, and fin type I have already told you in the case of that mix and unmix type of heat exchanger. So this is concentric tube type. So we are having larger diameter and smaller diameter tube pipeline. So this is how the fluids can flow, and the direction of flow as well as the temperature variation you can see. So this greener or bluer color is showing less temperature, and this color toward this redder side is hotter or higher temperature. This is shell and tube heat exchanger. So here you are seeing there are multiple tubes. In the tube side we are having inlet plenum, where the tube side fluid will be coming distributed individual tubes, and then at the outlet end also all the tubes are mixing their fluids together in the outlet plenum, and tube side fluids come out at side. In the shell side, you can see at the shell side we are having multiple passes by using these baffles. So in between there are some baffles. So there are these lateral sections so that the shell side fluid does not travel the short distance. It has to travel this longer distance, so that residence time for this fluid increases and the heat transfer process requires and gets that time for the heat exchange process to occur. So this is how the shell and tube heat exchanger works. So in this diagram it is showing that both side we are having multiple side passes. So here you can see the tube side fluid enters here, distributed into these tubes, then tubes are forming a U-turn here. So one more pass in the tube is occurring, and then tube side fluid is exiting at this end only. So at this end of the heat exchanger, so tube side fluid will be entering here, exiting here. But in the case of shell side, here you can see by using these baffles how this fluid can twist and turn again and again. So this is one pass, two pass, three, four, five, six pass of heat exchange at the shell side, and at the tube side we are having two passes. So this was regarding shell and tube heat exchanger. So many diagrams have been included for much more clarity. Now coming on to the compact type of heat exchanger. The compact type, that is plate heat exchanger, already explained to you. Then fin type, that was also explained. Now coming on to the next category, which is physical state of fluid. So with respect to physical state of fluids, we can have condensers and evaporators. So in these heat exchanger, what happens? Either fluid, one of the fluid at least, it gets condensed or it gets evaporated. So here this is a case of condenser. So in this case you are seeing this graph is showing you the time temperature distribution profile of it. So on the y-axis we are having temperature, on x-axis we are having length of heat exchanger. So you are seeing that cold fluid is getting heated up, so its temperature is increasing, but hot fluid is remaining at same one constant temperature. So in this case, hot fluid is being condensed, so it is just losing its latent heat, converting from liquid phase to vapor, vapor phase to liquid phase. So in this case, the liquid, whatever vapor, whatever is there in the hot fluid side, is converting into liquid phase. So temperature is not changed. Only latent heat is being transferred to the cold fluid side. In the case of evaporator, this straight line or the constant temperature side moves over to the cold fluids. Because in this case, what we are having, the fluid which is being evaporated is receiving the heat and it is utilizing that heat as its latent heat, and at the same temperature it gets evaporated. So whatever it is being received from the hot fluid side, hot fluid is reducing in its temperature, but cold fluid is not increasing its temperature. It is just transferring its phase from, or converting its phase from liquid phase to vapor phase. So whatever heat it is receiving is being utilized as latent heat of evaporation. Now, what are the considerations for heat transfer? We are having many considerations, just like fouling factor. Basically, fouling factor, what does fouling mean? Fouling means the material which deposit on the surface of heat exchanger may add further resistance to heat transfer. Okay, such deposits are termed as fouling. So these deposits, they reduce, significantly reduce the rate of heat transfer because they are coming in the path of heat exchange, and their properties, heat transfer properties, are not that good so that they can take part efficiently in the process of heat exchange. I have already told to you in the previous class what are the properties for heat transfer properties for materials which are used for conduction type of heat exchange. Basically, most important property was thermal conductivity, and thermal conductivity is low for the material which has been deposited, and hence it adds to the thermal resistance, so it reduces the performance of heat exchange. Scaling is most common form of fouling. So these are some form of fouling. Basically, it is associated with inverse solubility. Just like when we boil water in an open pan on a gas burner, then we can observe there are white colored deposits all over the heat transfer surface of that pan. So that white colored powdery material, that is the hardness of water. So they are soluble salts which were soluble before, and due to evaporation of water they have been irreversibly precipitated out. So they these salts are calcium carbonate, calcium sulfate, phosphate, silicate, hydroxides, etc. Then corrosion fouling, it is classified as chemical reaction which is involves heat exchanger tube. So the tubes of heat exchanger can react with the heat transfer fluids and they can form some corrosion markings or rusting. So that rusting or corroded part may remain in place and add to the thermal resistance. That is corrosion fouling. Chemical reaction fouling is different from corrosion fouling in the case that when we are referring to corrosion fouling, there the metallic part or the heat exchanger itself takes part in the heat, that reaction, chemical reaction. But in the case of chemical reaction fouling, the ingredients of the fluid, so the fluid can have several components. Those ingredients, due to temperature difference, either being heated or being cooled, they can react with each other and form some material to precipitate out, to deposit on the heat surface. So that will result into chemical reaction. Then freezing fouling, when something gets freeze onto the heat transfer surface, and that is adding the heat transfer resistance, so that will result into freezing fouling. Biological fouling is the growth of algae and other microbes or barnacles, etc., on the heat exchange surface. So that is biological fouling. Now coming on to the analysis part. Basically, this was related to the theory for heat exchangers. Now coming on to the mathematical equation or analytical part of heat exchange process, that how do we calculate how much heat transfer can occur through the heat exchanger, and if we know some of the properties, some of the physical states, either temperature or flow rates or etc., something like that, then how can we calculate or compute the performance of heat exchanger? So basically, for this analysis, what we need is we need 3D flow condition. 3D flow conditions means the temperature at any place at any given point should not change with respect to time. So whatever is the temperature at inlet will remain as such at that particular value for the period of study. And whatever is the value of that temperature throughout the length of heat exchange, whether it was hot fluid, cold fluid, or any type of fluid, it can also be mixed fluid if it was direct contact type of heat exchanger. So it does not change with respect to time. Temperature should not change. So that is what we known as is known as steady flow condition. So it will happen when we are not changing mass flow of the fluids, when we are not changing type of fluid. Means if it was water was flowing with 5% salt in it, then it should be 5% salt water also. It should not change if that 5% salt change to 6% salt in between, so that the properties of fluids do not change, basically specific. Now how the rate of heat transfer can be computed? It is very simple formula. Q is equal to mcp delta T. I have already told you in the previous classes. So Q is the rate of heat exchange, m dot, so here m is having a dot, so this is mass flow rate. If it was just m, it is mass. If it is m dot on top, it is mass flow rate. So it is in kg per second. Cph specifically, h subscript is for hot fluid, c subscript is for cold fluid, cp specific heat, I subscript is for inlet, O is for out. So C specific heat, P, Cp specific heat, H hot fluid, THI hot fluid inlet, THO hot fluid outlet, and this T is temperature. So this is how much heat will be transferred by hot fluid. So that will be the heat transfer received by cold fluid, which is given by Q is equal to mcp delta T. Again, in the case of cold fluid, it is TCO minus I, because now cold fluid outlet temperature will be higher than the inlet temperature, because when the cold fluid enters the heat exchanger, it is having lowest possible temperature whatever it can have, and when it comes out of heat exchanger, it has been heated a bit by the transfer of heat from hot fluid. So it will be TCO minus TI, but in the case of hot fluid, it will be THI minus THO. So THI means hot fluid inlet. This temperature will be higher than the hot fluid outlet, whether it is a counter current or co current or cross, whatever type of flow is there. Now coming on to the overall heat transfer. Overall heat transfer for any heat exchanger is given as Q is equal to UA delta T. So overall, whatever heat transfer from hot fluid side to cold fluid side is there is expressed or given as Q is equal to UA delta T, in which U is overall heat transfer coefficient, A is heat transfer area, which is the surface area through which heat exchanges, and delta T M is the logarithmic mean temperature difference. Because in the heat exchangers, as you have seen in these two equations, we are having four different temperatures. So as such, in overall heat exchanger, we cannot have delta T, because which temperatures will be used to compute that delta T will be debatable. So we are using logarithmic mean temperature difference. And what do we mean by that, and how do we calculate that? That is a question of derivation. So let us go to a derivation for parallel flow heat exchanger. So in this case, a double pipe heat exchanger has been shown to you in this diagram. So here you can see THI this side, THO this side, internal this inside tube hot fluid is there, TCI this side, TCO this side. So cold fluid also enters side also and exit at this side. So in this diagram, it is showing the temperature distribution profile of this parallel flow type of heat exchanger. So hot fluid THI highest temperature of all, cold fluid inlet lowest temperature of all, four temperatures are there, THI, THO, TCO, TCI. So what we are having is hot fluid is being cooled as it is going through the heat exchanger, cold fluid is being heated as it is going through the heat exchanger, and at the outlet we are having hot fluid coming out at a particular temperature, cold fluid coming out at a lower than hot fluid temperature at this particular value. So at this side of heat exchanger, we are having delta T1, which is difference between this temperature, inlet of hot fluid temperature, inlet of cold fluid. So this delta T1 is not with respect to inlets, it is with respect to side. We can mark any side to be 1, any side to be 2. So we are having two delta T's, so delta T1, delta T. So it can also be this is delta T1, this is delta T2. It does not matter. It's just a matter of choice. What do we choose? So delta T1 means temperature difference between this side of graph, irrespective of whether it was inlet or outlet for what fluid, whatever fluid. Delta T2 is temperature difference at this side of graph, whatever it was hot fluid, cold fluid, inlet, outlet, whatever it. Now for the derivation part, what we are doing is we are considering a small cross section of this heat exchanger, suppose here, which is having area dA, small area dA. In this area dA, hot fluid is reducing in temperature. So it was initially at this temperature. Finally, when it comes out from this dA length or dA area, it is at this temperature. So overall, it has loosened this minus dTH. In this much temperature, it is reduced. But for cold fluid, it has gained this temperature. So it was at previously at a lower value of temperature, and finally it came out at higher value of temperature. So DTC was the gain in temperature for the hot fluid. Overall, delta Q amount of heat transfer from hot fluid to cold fluid in this particular area. Overall, the temperature difference between the hot and cold fluid is delta T. So there is no one or two here. So initially, TH temperature for hot fluid, TC temperature for cold fluid, temperature increased by DTC for cold fluid. So it becomes T plus DTC. For hot fluid, it became TH minus DTH. Now, for this small volume or area of heat exchanger, if we apply those equations, so here this is equation for hot fluid, Q is equal to mCp delta T we are going to apply. So for small area, small heat is there, so small, so delta Q is equal to mHCph dTh. Negative sign here is indicating that whenever we are having, I have already told to you, whenever we are having any difference, whether it is temperature difference, thickness difference, whatever difference, it is always final minus initial. So DTH means after words value, which is lower, minus initial value, which was higher. So what we will be getting is, we will be getting a negative value. So to invert that sign, we are using this minus sign. In other words, you can also explain, you can also see in this manner that heat is being transferred in the direction of reducing. So if the temperature is reducing, heat is going out. So direction of heat flow and direction of temperature change are opposite to each other. That is why there is a negative sign. Are you getting this negative sign?
Yes, sir.
But for cold fluid, this is in same direction. As the temperature is increasing, heat is being received. So there is no negative sign here. So direction of temperature and heat flow is same for cold fluid, so there is no negative sign. And DTC for cold fluid is not negative, because whenever there is dx dt dy whatever it d is there, it is final minus initial. For cold fluid, final value is higher than initial value, so the value of DTC will be a positive point. So this is heat rejected by hot fluid. This equation is showing heat gained by cold fluid. So as heat, whatever is rejected by hot fluid is given to the cold fluid, both will be same, both will be equal to each other. And this delta T, overall temperature difference between hot and cold fluid, will be TH minus. If we differentiate this, then D delta T will be DTH minus DT. So this is DTH minus DT. Okay. So if we calculate the value of DTH and DTC from these two equations, 14.19 and 14.20, so it comes out to be this particular expression. So DTH is equal to minus DQ by mHCph. DTC comes out to be delta Q mCCpc. We can put this in this equation 14.22 and then solve. So by putting this, we get this form. So D delta T equal to delta Q. We are getting this particular quantity here, D delta T equal to minus DQ times this thing. So for overall heat exchanger, we are also having one more equation that that delta T, Q is equal to UA delta T. So U times delta T, and this is the small area, so this is dA. From here, if we replace this value of delta T, Q equal to this particular thing, then we are getting this equation. So here we are having differential equation in the form of delta T. So here we are having delta D delta T, and here we are having delta T. So separating these variables and rearranging this and integrating will give us the value of delta T as such. So we require how to solve for this delta T in this heat exchanger. So what we can do is delta T cube brought to this side, it becomes d delta T by delta T equal to minus UA, and this particular bracket, as it is constant, it is not having any variable, it is replaced by this constant d, so that we are not required to write this again and again this much expression. We will be replacing it at the final part and then integrating it with respect to these limits. So delta T ranges in between delta T1 to delta T2, and dA, here we are having dA ranges from 0 to overall area A. So integrating this, it gives log natural of this equals to this particular value. So what we can do is we can then put the value of B again and then replace the value of MHCPH and MCCPC from the previous equation. So here you can see if we find out the value of MHCPH from here, so it will be DQ divided by DTH and it would be minus. For MCCPC, it will be DQ divided by DTC without minus. So that can be placed here, and for DQ and DTH and DTC, we can use this particular value. So it is THI minus TCHO, TCO minus THCI, and then we can rearrange this and put back in the form of Q is equal to UA delta T. So U and A are already there. Whatever is left, that will be the expression for delta T. So we are left with this expression, which is delta T1 minus delta T2 divided by log natural of delta T1 by delta T2. So this is what is the value of delta T LM. And if we can, we can also invert the signs here. If we invert the sign at the numerator, denominator also changes. So multiplying with the negative 1 on both numerator and denominator, it switches these sides. So delta T1 minus delta T2 becomes delta T2 minus delta T1. Log natural delta T1 by delta T2 becomes log natural delta T2 by delta T1. So that was why I was telling you that it does not matter that what side you are referring to as 1 and what side you are referring to as side 2. And this expression is known as logarithmic mean temperature difference, as we are having log natural here, and this is a temperature difference, and this is a mean between these two sides of heat exchanger. So here you are seeing for parallel flow heat exchanger, this is delta T1, this is delta T2. For counter flow heat exchanger, this is delta T1, this is delta T2. So here we are having THI minus TCO as delta T1, but here it was THI minus TCI, not TC, and similarly for delta T2. So this is a similar derivation for counter flow. You can just go through it, and in this case we will be having negative sign for both, because hot fluid is decreasing in temperature and cold fluid is flowing in reverse direction. In the previous direction for cold fluid, there was not a minus sign here. Here there was no minus sign, but in this case, in this derivation, there is a minus sign. And also DTC is also having a negative value here, because when we are referring to this equation, this graph, in this dA, this is final value, this is initial value. So for cold fluid also, final value is less, initial value is high, so DTC is negative sum, just like this. But this negative sign for cold fluid is because now cold fluid is transferring, now cold fluid is flowing in reverse direction. Just a second again. The rest of the steps are similar. Now for the case of condensers, there is a special case for evaporators and condenser, as we are having a fixed constant value of temperature for one of the fluid. So if it is hot fluid, as in the case of condenser, there is no THI, THO, but we are having only one single value, TH, because we are not having a change in temperature for hot fluid because it was condensed. For the case of evaporators, the TC remains same. So there, for cold fluid, we are not having TCI and TCO, we are having one single value, TC. So that would be used. Okay, so this is how condenser and evaporators this temperature distribution profile looks like and the value of T delta T1 and delta T2. Multipass I have already explained to you. Now one more method is there, so we will be leaving this particular method aside because this is not relevant as far as your course content is there. You can still go through it, there is no harm in that. Now coming on to this part here, rating of heat exchanger. How do we rate heat exchanger? Especially rating of heat exchanger is done on these data. What are these data? These data are inlet temperature, THI and TCI, mass flow rate, MH and MC, physical properties, CPC, CPH, overall heat transfer coefficient, which is U, heat transfer area A, and heat transfer rate Q. What is the methodology which is adopted? It is based on, we should calculate the C. C is the C minimum by C maximum. It is based on that part which we have just skipped. You can just refer to that. This is regarding how a heat exchanger is rated. As we are, suppose we are purchasing or we are going for selection of any equipment, then what we need to see is, we need to see its rating. What is the capacity of a particular equipment? Suppose we are going to purchase a pasteurizer, that what is the capacity of pasteurizer? So it is given in the form of 10,000 liter per hour, but we already know for what purpose we are using that equipment. So that would be a milk pasteurizer, means we are required to achieve a temperature of at least 71.5 degree Celsius and then hold it for 15 seconds at least. Then it has to be cooled immediately to less than 7 degree Celsius. So those many things we already know. So only flow rates are given because these temperatures are predefined that. But in general, for any heat exchangers, these temperature and this performance data is required to be given for rating. Now coming on to the sizing, this is the particular procedure. Here in this case, you can just go through it and just see this equation. So this particular equation is used for calculation of overall heat transfer coefficient. So overall heat transfer coefficient, it is calculated by this equation. In this equation, what overall heat transfer coefficient is given as 1 over this particular expression. This is dO by dHi Hi plus dO by dI RFi plus dO by 2k ln RO minus RI plus RFO plus 1 upon HO. What are these? Basically, overall heat transfer coefficient is calculated as an average of all the things which are taking part in heat exchange process. What are the things which are taking part in heat exchange process? We are having inside convection. Suppose we are having a pipeline. That pipeline, there will be convective heat transfer going on. So we will be having convection. Then after that, we can have some fouling. So that fouling will pose a fouling resistance. So this RF part is for fouling resistance. These D's are for diameters. Outside diameter DO, inside diameter TI. HI is inside convection coefficient. RFI and RFO here. These are distances to heat flow due to those fouling. Fouling factor is this. Then, as the pipeline is curved, we are having this conduction resistance. So, due to conduction, when heat transfers, we are also having some resistance. So, that resistance due to conduction is given by this expression, which is TO by 2K. K is the thermal conductivity of the part of the material which is making the wall of those pipeline, and R is for radii, for radiuses, and HO for outside heat, convection coefficient.